Hi, I'm Len Epp from Leanpub, and in this Leanpub Front Matter podcast, I'll be interviewing Tracy Osborn. Based in Toronto, Tracy is the founder of the popular wedding planning and services site WeddingLovely, and a popular speaker as well as the author of a number of books that help people learn how to code and also how to design. Tracy's books, inspired, I believe, by her own experience teaching herself how to code, include Hello Web App, its sequel, Hello Web App Intermediate Concepts, and her latest, Hello Web Design, Design Fundamentals and Shortcuts for Non-Designers. The book is based on Tracy's Design for Non-Designers conference presentation, which she has delivered at conferences all over the world, including GitHub's CodeConf LA 2016, the Mozilla ViewSource Conference 2016, and a keynote talk at O'Reilly's Fluent Conference 2016. You can follow Tracy on Twitter at LimeDaring and learn more about her work on the web at hellowebbooks.com/news and her personal website LimeDaring.com. In this interview, we're going to talk about Tracy's career path, learning how to code, founding a startup, her successful Kickstarter campaigns for her books, and at the very end, we'll talk a little bit about her experience as a self-published author. So thank you, Tracy, for being on the Front Matter podcast.
Thank you. That was quite a comprehensive introduction.
Yeah, I like to do a fair amount of research, maybe more than I ought to for these podcasts. I like to get to know the person a little bit in advance.
Yeah, it sounds like a lot of stuff to cover.
Yeah, well, you've done a lot. I always like to start these interviews by asking people for their origin story. So I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about your early life and your education and how you originally became a web designer.
Sure. I was really lucky that I had several family members of mine who worked in computers early on. So I was born in 1984, and all of my life I remember having a computer. And it's one of those, like, you know, like the old Mac with a really tiny 4-inch screen, or the ones that have those I wish I remember the names of those, but those giant floppies. Like, one of my earliest memories is having one of those little catalogs where you can just paw through all the floppies, and family members who worked in tech would just give us all these random things. And it was like, oh, what is this one? You put it in the computer and, oh, it's a coloring game. And I don't know. I was really lucky to grow up surrounded by computers, especially because I lived in a rural area. So the choices were, oh, go play outside and climb mountains, or stay inside on a computer. And of course, I chose to just fuss around these giant floppies and figure out how computers worked, and spent all my time indoors playing on them, computers from 1986 on, or around that time. So in high school, that's when the internet really started becoming a thing. And I discovered in high school that it was a quick, easy A if I made a website rather than writing a book report. So I'd be like, oh, go research Jonas Salk. And instead of writing whatever pages of your book report I had to do, I'd make a website and just, like, put a paragraph of information on each page of the website. But websites were so new that the teachers were like, wow, you put this on the internet. And I could all, they would all pull it up from their computers in the classroom on whatever slow internet connection we were on. It just blew their mind. And it became my way of getting an easy A when I was in high school. And so that's kind of where the web stuff started with me, is I used it to skate through assignments. And when I went to university, I thought, because I loved computers and loved building websites, I was like, oh, naturally I'll go do computer science. And that's a whole story on its own. But I went to Cal Poly San Luis Obispo in California for computer science, and quickly found out I hated university level programming. So I switched my degree over to art. I decided to do, like, a complete 180 and go to the opposite direction because I thought I hated programming. Finished my university degree in art. Got a job in doing front-end development, just HTML and CSS, after university. And after I left that job, that's when I looked back at programming and I decided to launch a startup because I was in the Bay Area and that's what everyone does.
And if I could just interrupt you there, what was it about university programming class, the program that you hated so much?
Yeah, it's so I wrote, jumping ahead a little bit, I wrote Hello Web App because I didn't like the way that programming is taught. And I really realized that in university, because I wrote my books in a way that's teaches programming a more visual, a more concrete way, where you're actually building something. Whereas my university education back in the day was very theory-based for the first few classes. Like my first quarter class, we were building things. But the key class for me was this theory class at the end of my first year. And it just murdered me trying to, we had to reverse engineer sorting methods and create this report showing how we showing the timing of the sorting methods that we've reverse engineered and proving that bubble sort was, these are all things I barely remember, but bubble sort was better than other sorting method. And this, it was just not fun to me. I learn better when I'm building something, and this class and the teacher also involved in the class really didn't like me. And once accused me over email of when I wasn't getting something, he accused me of just trying to skate my way through the class and was really mean. And it's a whole long story. And I was like, I hate this. And so that's why I switched my major. I sometimes want to take my books back to that professor and be like, haha, see, I actually did learn programming. I learned Python. It's much better than Java, which is what we were doing too.
That's a really interesting story. Not only because of the element of, you know, personal relationship that came into it, which is one of the pitfalls of university life that people often don't talk about, that, you know, their professors are people and they can take a dislike to someone.
Yeah.
And they can actually personally take it out on people. And it's such a perilous journey in that. But also there's actually a sort of unofficial theme of this podcast, which is that, you know, because so many of our authors are Leanpub authors that we interview are, programming folk.
Mm-hmm.
I find about half formally studied computer science and about half didn't. And I always like to ask people things change so fast. If you were starting out again now, I guess I know the answer for you, the question I'd like to ask people is, would you go into computer science or would you just strike out on your own if your goal was to have a job as a, you know, developer in tech?
Mm-hmm. I bet a lot of people, there's so many resources online now for teaching yourself, which is awesome. One of the reasons why I wrote my own book is I found it really easy. I say easy in air quotes, which you can't see. It's like easy enough to write my own resource I wish existed rather than say, you know, going back and spending 4 years in university. That said, I don't want to hate on my university too much because I just found out that they've revamped our computer science program at Cal Poly. And now they teach Python and then they do, you know, now these introductory classes are building real things, which brings me so much joy to know that some of these university courses are taking the criticisms around teaching computer science and they're starting to update it to be more applicable to the real world now. So yay, Cal Poly, I'm really happy to hear that.
I think, you know, it's funny you're giving me an opportunity to ask another type of question, which is for those of our listeners who might be technical types who've never gone near an art class, what did you study as an art major?
I was my specialization was graphic design. The degree name officially was art and design. And I loved art in high school as well. I just kind of did art classes and played around the computers. It's a funny thing about being an author is I am terrible at grammar and spelling and all those writing things. That was definitely my worst classes in university and high school. But my two things were art and computers. And when I switched to graphic design, I was in this I hate computers moment because I switched out of computer science and I was planning on becoming a product designer, doing labels on wines or packaging. But I kind of fell back into doing web stuff while I was in university because there was this startup, like literally a bunch of guys in a garage down the street from the university. They were building this startup around online education lead generation, and they needed a designer, and I needed the job. So while I was in university for graphic design, I started working with them doing the front end development, and I ended up working with them for 4.5 years, so 3.5 years after my graduation. So I fell back into computers that way, even though my plan while I was studying art was to become a package designer.
And so you did spend 5 years working as a web designer. And can you describe mm-hmm. a little bit to people what the day-to-day life is like of a web designer? What's the first thing you do?
I will say that my experience is probably really different than other people's because it was a startup and it started out as just a bunch of friends working together, building a startup and trying to get rich together, which it didn't really work out. I'm not going to go too much into this, but it was one of those classic cases where I never got anything in writing. And then after the company was successful, it didn't. And then I tried to get things in writing. It didn't match with what my expectations were, which is why I left the startup. That said, for a long time, it was just a bunch of friends working together. And I also was the only designer at this company, which was a good and bad thing, because when I started working with them, I didn't know CSS. And I didn't know, I mean, this is when CSS just started becoming a thing. And I didn't know CSS. I didn't know a lot of modern web tools, because my graphic design degree, while it did have web design classes, the web design classes were already outdated. We were doing Flash and Dreamweaver stuff when HTML and CSS were and still are, you know, the way to build websites. So at this job, I didn't have any designers telling me what to do, anyone leading. I had to really educate myself. And this was a great place for me to learn web design, because this company had a slew of different websites. They had about 13 different properties. And when I was hired, it was like, okay, Tracy, redesign this property. So I would do a redesign of one and then move on to the other. And by the time I finished the last one, I learned so much in that process that my web design skills had gotten so much better that I had the opportunity to go back and start redesigning them over again. So my 4.5 years there were really me deciding what I need to learn and how to apply it to the properties at this business, and what I needed to educate myself with and what conference I need to go to. And that was awesome. That was a really great opportunity for me to really learn how to work for myself while still having a company around me. And this is what really led to me feeling comfortable starting a startup and working for myself entirely.
Yeah, that's what I'd like to ask you about next. But yeah, I'd like to repeat, I guess, your implied warning to anyone listening, considering getting into a startup with somebody. You're going to spend a lot of your life in that endeavor. Take a moment to sit down and read the fine print.
Oh yeah.
And really understand the contracts that you're getting into. It's worth the time. There's a really good book by Brad Feld. I'll put the title in the show notes because I can't remember it right now. That's now a few years old, but it's really helpful when it comes to that kind of stuff. And yeah, I mean, we've all had that experience where you're just so excited and you just take things for granted.
Yeah. You think you're working with a bunch of friends and we'll all take care of each other. But as soon as money enters that equation, you're not really friends anymore. You have to watch out for yourself.
Yes. And also, I mean, one form of startup success is investment coming in. And, you know, all of a sudden when there's other people looking at you, it can make a big difference if you've got your house in order.
Yeah, totally.
As opposed to if it's just a kind of, you know, messy basement that you've got there. So you decided to, you had an idea for the startup. And can you talk a little bit about what that idea was and maybe, I mean, how it came to you, if there's any story behind that?
Yeah. So that summer, I started dating my now husband, who during that summer, it was a summer after I quit my job. And before I started the startup, I decided to do freelance design and see if I could just make a living by freelancing. Now, during the summer, I was lucky that Andre, my husband, started his own startup, and he went through Y Combinator in Silicon Valley. And for me, contracting design, this gave me an easy in to Y Combinator companies that need designers. So I was able to work with several companies in his batch. Reportive, which was sold to LinkedIn at this point, but I believe my website design for Reportive is still up. It was like a Gmail sidebar. I worked with a few others in his batch, and it was a really great summer in that I was able to see startups working and get really inspired by what my husband was doing, my then boyfriend, and what these other companies were doing. And I also learned that I really didn't like freelancing, because while these companies are great, I had such strong ideas. And, you know, with freelancing, you really have to work with the client and work with their ideas. And I started to get a little strong-headed and thought to myself that I'd much rather do design just for myself. And I was so inspired by these startups that I was like, okay, do design only for myself. That means I can start my own startup and start building something. So I kind of just decided that I like startups and I wanted to work for myself. And the thing was, with my university experience with computer science, I had no intention of learning how to program. I thought that I was a terrible programmer. I'm still haunted by those days. So I did this process over about 3 months of trying to find my co-founder, my technical co-founder. And I went through so many meetups. I went to a conference about finding co-founders. And all these places, these like find your co-founder, it's like 99% marketing people looking for like the one technical person in the audience. It's like a terrible way of starting a company. But I thought I couldn't program. And so I needed to find that person to work with me. And I wrote a blog post that went on Hacker News. And that actually went really well on Hacker News. I got something like 200 upvotes. I did all these interviews and narrowed it down to one person. And we started working on a startup together, which is not WeddingLovely. It was kind of like precursor. And we got a Y Combinator interview. And I thought I was doing everything right. Like, oh, cool. I actually have my co-founder and I have my startup. And we have a Y Combinator interview. And that the day before the interview, just everything erupted, exploded. And it was like obvious that him and I could not work together because we only knew each other for about a month at that point. And it's a really bad idea to start a startup with somebody you only know for a month, which why have we had that big explosion? So when that exploded and we did the interview, but did not get into Y Combinator, which was a good thing because we couldn't work together. That's when I was like, okay, well, if I actually want to work for myself and I want to do design for myself and I want a startup, that means I need to actually learn how to build the startup myself. So that's pushed me finally into learning how to program.
And just actually get another kind of comment. Those kinds of explosions are not unusual.
Yeah.
And as you say, especially if you've only known people a short time, but I mean, you know, the longer you get to know people, the more explosions you're going to have with them. And it's learning how to weather them and manage them. That's a part of a good, successful.
Right. Which is, you know, I've seen so many, I have had living in Silicon Valley and being so close to all these startup incubators and doing them myself and seeing all these startups. It's like co-founder issues are the number one thing that seems to break up a company, especially early days, because people, it's really great when you can find the best person to work with. However, you know, if, like it can really fray friendships and break startups apart when things are going downhill.
Yeah, it's interesting that just very briefly, I had an experience where I worked on we could call it a startup. It was a nonprofit startup type thing in the art space. And it was going to be an annual, basically crowdfunded annual poetry anthology and prize.
Cool.
Very big prize. It was $50,000. It was in its own way very high pressure. And it was after we pulled it off that finally the tension between myself and one of my co-founders could no longer be contained.
Mm-hmm.
Because we pulled it off. And as long as we've been in service of this goal, you know, all the fights and disagreements, you know, were resolved in one way or another because we were committed to achieving what we were set mm-hmm. to do. But once we pulled it off the first time, the goal was to be annual, you know, it just was obviously untenable at that point. It is an interesting thing about that particular form of, I mean, you know, there's office politics everywhere, but this startup life is just so intense, or can be so intense. And so, well, speaking of relationships and fights and pulling things off, how did you get the idea for wedding services?
Yeah, it's sometimes a little embarrassing to be like, I have a wedding startup because I'm a woman. And it feels like it's so cliche. Of course, the wedding startup for a woman. And the thing is, I actually hate weddings. I like attending weddings, but I think the wedding industry is absolutely ridiculous, which is why it's especially funny that I'm running this wedding startup. But I love small businesses. And this whole thing started out as a designer, as I wanted to support small graphic design businesses. And I decided that if I'm going to learn how to code, I need to have a small, easy, achievable idea to teach myself how to code with. And I landed on building a directory of wedding invitation designers because I wanted a better way for people to find invitation designers near them. and work with them rather than, say, using some of the big companies like Minted or Wedding Paper Divas or these other online invitation companies. I was like, okay, how can I help graphic designers working from home who designed wedding invitations? How do I get them more clients? So that's how it really started, is weddings was this the niche that I landed in, which is funny now that WeddingLovely has moved on from just one directory of invitation designers. And then I built a directory for planners and a directory for photographers. And then I had to tie all these directories together. And then I built a wedding planning app on top of that. So you can put in your wedding dates and your preferences. And it kind of builds a little walkthrough for weddings. Now that I've built all those things, they always, like, one led to another after another after another. I still am very critical of the wedding industry, and I'm really critical about what it pushes people to do. And when I got married, I went to Las Vegas. I went to the Little White Wedding Chapel and I eloped. It's a little funny, a little bit of dissonance between what I do and my own personal feelings, but I'm hoping that what I've been working on with WeddingLovely will help change the industry for the better.
And what is it about the industry that, I mean, I can guess, but, you know, here's another chance to have your say about what it is that you don't like about the wedding industry.
What's going on with weddings, the push to have, like, the perfect wedding, the big wedding, the fact that weddings cost $28,000 on average across the U.S., right now, and that's wow. That's on average. And places like New York City, obviously the results get skewed, but I think New York City is at $40,000 for a wedding. It's ridiculous. And everyone knows that. And everyone says, oh, I'm not going to spend that much money. And then they start planning their wedding and it just racks up and racks up and racks up because you have all these expectations. Like, your wedding must have beautiful photography. You must have videography, must have favors, you must have flowers, and which creates these beautiful experiences you can look back on, but at what cost? So I'm hoping that WeddingLovely, I've been trying to put in ways to be like, okay, cool, you can have this experience that you're kind of been trained to want through culture, but here's ways that you can do them more cheaply, or you can don't feel like you're compelled to use all the traditions that are on there, because a lot of traditions are just been made by marketing companies, like diamond rings. And they wanted to put a place where it said it's okay not to follow tradition, it's okay not to do what everyone else is doing. Like, that at its end, a wedding should just be a big party to celebrate the fact that you've decided to live your life with another person.
You know, that's really interesting. You just reminded me of an old memory. My mom did her master's degree in sociology in the 1970s. And one of the things she researched was where people got in North America, got their contemporary idea mm-hmm. of the wedding ceremony and what weddings should be like. And what she found, and take this with a grain of salt, because it was a young woman doing her master's in the 1970s. But what she did find was that it came from the girls that she interviewed, or the young women that she interviewed, got their ideas of what a wedding should be like from their mothers, who got their image from soap operas that they'd been
soap operas, yeah.
I'm sure the market, you know, there's always this, you know, sort of, you know, feedback effect of marketing and television and how things are represented. Mm-hmm. But I just remembered that was a very interesting thing, that it was representations of weddings in fiction mm-hmm. that ended up driving reality, which is one of those things that's, like, not surprising when you say it or until you say it.
Mm-hmm.
It's surprising until you say it. Probably the best formulation. So you had this idea, and then you knew you needed to learn how to code. So how did you go about learning how to code?
I was lucky that my same boyfriend, now husband, who went through Y Combinator, was skilled in Python. So he kind of helped me learn Python, directed me towards resources around Django, which is a framework on Python to help you build web apps, which is, and incidentally, my book, Hello Web App, is on. And Django, because it has a lot of hand holding for, it kind of abstracts a lot of the programming work away. So it builds an admin, it has all these helper methods, so you can build like have password management and all that kind of stuff built in. It made it easy enough for me to follow along the tutorial that I was teaching how to build a blog, and I was able to alter it in order to build a directory. So I kind of taught myself how to code as I was building this initial website. And I didn't really understand how things were working, which I am a big fan of now. I'm like, you know, just build and you'll figure things out along the way. That's another reason why I built, wrote Hello Web App. But yeah, so I built this very minimal website, and then I need to learn how to add payments. So then I would research PayPal and research Stripe, and I would learn more about programming, and I'd integrate that feature. And then I'd be like, oh, now I need to add geolocation. So research that and add it in, and then I've learned something new. So this whole process of learning how to code was really just me building WeddingLovely.
Yeah, as you say, I think in your books, you learn by doing. It's one of your mantras. And as I understand it, and I think it was in fall 2011 that you got taken up by 500 startups and their designer fund. I'm not exactly sure what that is, but were you part of an incubator?
Yeah, so 500 Startups Incubator, technically, so Designer Fund has evolved since then. But at the time, Designer Fund is this group in San Francisco to help designer founders. And at the time, they did have like a batch incubator-ish program. So I originally went through that. And then at the end of that, I was accepted into 500 Startups, which was really awesome because I was then and still like a solo founder. So it was good to have 500 Startups give me the stamp of approval and accept me into the program. And I got the investments from that as well. So it was a very interesting 3 months as all incubators. I think everyone who's gone through an incubator would say, I'm glad that I did it. I learned so much while I was there, and I was able to grow WeddingLovely while I was there.
And where did you have to move for those 3 months?
Thankfully not. Because I lived in Silicon Valley already, I was in San Jose. So, and 500 Startups there at the time, their main incubator was in Mountain View, which I think now they're San Francisco and Mountain View. So it was a quick 20 or so minute drive up to the office for me to go up there.
And so what was that like being in an incubator as a sort of independent, you know, solo startup person? Would you just meet with other people in your batch? Talk about your challenges and things like that.
Yeah, 500 Startups. I'm not sure if they still do this, but at the time they required you to buy a desk to them, so you had a space to work. And I wish one of the things, if I had a genie and I could go back in time and do something over, I really wish I could redo my 500 Startups experience, because there was a few things that, like one of the things that kind of affected my experience there was that they had another wedding company in the batch, and they actually took that other wedding company and put us together in the same group of desks and thinking that we'd work together. But what happened really was that we were not friends. We were kind of competing with each other, which is not usually incubators avoid having competing companies in the same batch. And we ended up competing, which they had a big team. Like their website has since they've been long gone. I've lasted way longer than them, and they've moved on to other things. But at the time, they looked more successful. They sounded more successful. They had a bigger team than me. And I am not without, affected by anxiety sometimes, as we all are. And it was just a very anxious time for me to be working on my own website and my own startup, having this other group of people seemingly doing better than me, and also getting all the investment at demo day. Because if someone's going to invest in one wedding company, they're going to invest in that company, not me. So if I could do anything, I would love to redo 500 Startups and start it from scratch and not be competing with someone. And I think I would have a better experience. But there was that, because that happened during my time there, it kind of affected how the whole thing went for me.
Yeah, that's a really interesting story. I had been under the impression that as a general rule, I mean, not only incubators, but VCs themselves do not like to back competing companies. I hadn't thought about that very specific reality that you face, which is part of being in an incubator. It's generally is that you have a demo day where you present to potential investors. And I mean, if you're competing on that day, you have the pretense that you'd be, mates, along the way to that very big day is just pretty ridiculous. Actually, I've got a very brief story so about how competitive things can be. So once for an app that I was helping out with. We were in the demo pit at a conference in San Francisco, and we bought a big, at the time, you know, big like 56-inch screen TV that sort of basically took up as much space as we were permitted to have, and it was 4K. And the screen itself, you know, was enough to sort of attract people to our booth. And there were these two guys next to us who had their own very different app, but they had a tiny little normal monitor. And in the morning, but by the afternoon, they had a similar display because they looked ridiculous next to us. And it's just, I mean, that's a petty example. But it is, I mean, it's simple things like that. Can actually just get people really, you know, they were thinking about it, and they had, they should have, and they were right to. And so, eventually you found your way to deciding to write a book. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about, what led you to that.
Yeah, I love, I'm so happy that I took the leap into, to writing a book, and because it was kind of a big, it was a huge leap because I was in the middle of working on Wedding Lovely. And admittedly, I was getting a little burnt out. Like Wedding Lovely, I've talked about in other podcasts. There's a whole other story and the whole running a startup thing. And the long story short was I started getting burnt out and things weren't going very well for me for a while. And I decided to write a book as a way to, A, bring in more money, because everyone... I was reading a lot of articles online about people writing books. I think Nathan Barry was one of my inspirations. He's written and self-published quite a few books. And I was like, oh, you know what? I've been looking at this process of learning how to code. Since I taught myself how to code, I had learned so much. I was involved in the Django industry, and I was seeing what other people were doing and waiting for someone else to write a better tutorial. After I learned things, I was like, wow, they're really teaching us a terrible way. You know, maybe someday someone will write a better tutorial about how to teach web development. And that didn't happen. So I was burnt out and wanted a side project, to, you know, distract my brain from what was going on in startup life. So I decided to write a Hello Web app and, teach Django web app development the way I thought it should be taught, which was, you know, more visual way, more project-based, like the learn by doing, which incidentally at my university is their motto is learn by doing. So I kind of stole that from Cal Poly. But yeah, it's learning by in Hello Web App, I have like a project skeleton. I say you're building a collection of things, and that collection of things that can be applied to many things that are like a Twitter is a collection of tweets or a collection of short sentences, and Pinterest is a collection of images. Instagram is a collection of images. A directory, like what I built originally, is a collection of people. So I show people how to build a collection of things in Hello Web App, and I'd say, okay, here's where you would update it. Like I say, object. And you can change that object to post or picture or sentence. And my goal is that someone will actually build something that's unique, not just building the skeleton, but actually laying something unique on top of that. And hopefully that will help the information insert itself into their brain and help it stick. And people hopefully will learn by doing, really.
And your latest book, which was just published recently, is Hello Web Design.
Because I'm clever with my names.
Yeah, in fact, I think I remember from reading one of the earlier books, you actually had the idea for Hello Web Design near the beginning, of, like at the time that you were publishing Hello Web App. Is that correct?
I've been working on it. I have this idea kicking around my brain for a long time because, you know, when I'm teaching programming to designers, I naturally start thinking, oh, I can teach maybe design to programmers. So I decided to test out the ideas of Hello Web Design by building a conference presentation. And because I was still working for myself and I have free time to travel, I decided to take that conference presentation and apply it to so many conferences. And I ended up giving it probably at 12 different conferences. I'm guessing at the number, but that's what it feels like. The Design for Non-Designers presentation I've given at so many different conferences, which was awesome because I was able to test the material and see people being excited about it. And I was also able to travel. So I went to Berlin and I went to Buenos Aires, Argentina, and all over the world. But the problem was, is I was giving this conference presentation and getting good feedback and then traveling to another place and giving the conference presentation that during this time, I actually did no writing. And so it took me a lot longer to actually get the book out because I was distracting myself by doing all this wonderful travel, which sounds like a nice problem to have. But it was kind of ridiculous, like 2 years after or whatever, I forget what time it was, but a good period of time after my first conference presentation, I was like, and I'm now finally working on the book.
And actually, just to pause there for a moment, one of the constituencies of this podcast, of people that listen to it, is people who are trying to replicate the success of the people who are interviewed. And I wonder if you could talk a little bit about your experience getting into conference presenting. I believe you had a blog post about it or something where you talked about how, you know, you sent out lots and lots of proposals.
Yeah,
there is necessarily get, you know, not everyone was accepted.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of myths when it comes to conference proposals. I'll say that I find there's a really distinct difference between design conferences and programming conferences, and that design conferences are a little bit more curated. They're usually invited presenters. It's usually the same, around the same group of people presenting at most design conferences. And it's very hard to break into design conference speaking. That said, programming conferences, there are, it feels like a billion and a half different kinds of programming conferences out there. They're usually very encouraging of new speakers. And because there's so many different conferences out there, their chances of speaking at these conferences is a lot higher. That said, because programming conferences are a lot diverse and new speakers, and there's so many of them, it's less likely that you'll have your travel and accommodation covered by programming conferences, much less a stipend. Whereas design conferences, you might actually get your travel covered. So personally, I haven't done many design conferences. It's been always been an awesome experience when I've been able to speak at design conferences. But programming conferences are the best place, I think, for someone wanting to jump into programming. Programming conferences are the best place for someone who wants to jump into conference speaking. It's a really good environment to really test out talking in front of an audience. And the last thing I want to say is that I'm saying, you know, anyone who wants to speak at a conference, go to a programming conference. You know, what happens if you don't want to speak about programming? The secret there is that programming conferences usually have a diverse track of information, diverse tracks. And I was giving my design talk at these programming conferences, and I've given a talk on content writing. I have another talk on marketing. So even if you don't know programming and you don't know the languages, or you don't you're not a programmer yourself, you can create something that you specialize in. You can create a talk on that, and just what can you teach programmers? And then you can get into the conference speaking world by, you know, taking your talk, you know, whatever you want to say for programmers, and submit that to programming conferences. And then you can start getting into that world by going to these smaller conferences.
And as I understand it, one of the sort of tack you take in your talk and in your book, Hello Web Design, is that often design books, and I've read a couple of them myself, are directed at people who are, you know, presumed to be aiming to become expert designers.
Yeah.
And you've got a pretty strong opinion about that I think, I'll let you say it, but as I understand it briefly, the idea is that for a lot of people who are, you know, approaching design, it's not necessarily because they want to become expert web designers, and they don't necessarily need to be learning, you know, why it's, you know, F gray or whatever color it is.
Yeah, I find this happens in both programming and design, where an expert person is teaching someone who's not an expert, and they have a tendency to just sidetrack into the background or the whys or the history about something, where that, well, I find that actually distracts from getting from someone from zero to one. Like, you can teach history and the whys of things after someone has a basic grasp or a feeling. I feel like someone needs to have a success moment for them to learn something new. They need to have an early success feeling, like they can actually achieve something, and then they'll start diving in deeper, and then those additional explanations will start being relevant and would make sense to them. So for design, you know, you open a design book and they talk about typography and they're like, all right, let's talk about the printing press. And for someone who's a programmer, who's just like, okay, I want to do better, make better slides. You know, learning about the printing press is interesting, but not relevant at that moment. So with Hello Web Design, I've, you know, taken all that explanation out. There's like a little bit, but I try to focus on the bare minimum explanation about why something is the way it is, just so you have the stuff that you actually need to know. And then I really focus on shortcuts, because you don't need to know the hard way of doing something when you're just trying to make better slides. You just want to know, how can I get a better color combination? Like, how do I choose the colors for my slides? And I try to distill it down into a really quick and easy chapter. So you can actually, in, you know, 15 minutes, have a better way of choosing colors rather than spending hours learning about color theory.
Yeah, I believe one of your... one of the points you make is that if you're, you know, if you've got a practical goal, which is, you know, I want to build a website or something like that, don't steal, but definitely borrow or take inspiration or find precedents and templates and things like that, at least as a starting point, rather than, you know, start from scratch.
Yeah, I think a lot of new designers think that they need to be able to work, you know, take everything off their desk and have a blank slate, and then they can start designing from scratch. And then they're stuck with their pen in their hand going, wait, how do I actually start this? Where do I go? I don't have any ideas. And it could spiral into anxiety. But that, I think that happens to every designer, no matter how much experience they have. And the key to get around that is to start looking at inspiration, seeing what other people are doing, and get ideas from people. Because this is where, that's why I try to be very clear, is you shouldn't steal designs. But for new designers, if you're wanting to build a homepage for your startup, looking at other people's homepages and seeing what they're doing and seeing, getting inspired by where the navigation goes or what kind of content you want, and getting ideas from that and then designing, makes the design process go so much faster and so much easier than if you, rather than, you know, starting from a blank slate with no inspiration at all.
I've got actually a couple of design questions from the sort of, you know, normal user's perspective. So, you know, everybody basically, you know, is interacting with designed things on screens all the time now. And it's become a very important, feature of our lives. And, you know, just before this interview, I had what I think is a familiar experience for a lot of people, which is I had something important happening and I booted up Skype, and all of a sudden all sorts of updates I had to do. And I went to update my call recorder, and which is recording this audio. And then when I updated that, it automatically chose to update Skype. And all of a sudden I was like Geordi LaForge on an alien ship. And I'm like, okay, well, I don't know where anything is anymore, but I know this is a communications app. And so just like, you know, Geordi would know, okay, well, it's a spaceship, so it's got some propulsion and it's got some navigation and it's got weapons and it's got life support. You look around for the combinations of things and you can figure out where things are. But from a designer's perspective, how do you relate to that new reality that, you know, everybody has to just be so resourceful now all the time and anticipate this kind of situation?
Well, I will say that one of the things I like about teaching design is that it helps people who are building these experiences. If you have a little bit of design knowledge, hopefully given through Hello Web Design, it helps you remember the user experience is more important than how it looks. And I'm hoping that that helps people who are building these interfaces creates better when they're, you know, you're creating a new experience or you're creating a new design, to always remember that keeping the user experience easy and easy to understand is important. So, I mean, Skype obviously has designers on our team that are thinking about that, but that when you're talking about like loading something new and all of a sudden being like, oh crap, how does this work? I just think of helping people. One second, let me start over. One of the things when you're working on an app, I think it's someone who is like a programmer building an app forgets that it's important to how things are working. And then when they're thinking about how things are working, it's where the buttons are located to help someone understand how the app works. Because there's some conventions in app design that people forget about, or someone who's a programmer doesn't realize that there's a reason why usually the buttons, the menus are on the top left, because everyone's used to that. So you don't want to move it on someone because it's going to throw off how they use that app. So what I want to say is, like, adding design thinking when you're a programmer and you're building these interfaces is going to help you create better interfaces. It's going to help you realize those what's underneath that needs to be built in to help people have a better experience. And what was the other the main question you had?
The main question I was asking there is, as a designer, you know, I guess I'll re-ask it. I mean, as a designer, you always want to be designing more and changing things. And from a user's perspective, the introduction of that element of change becomes a part of the product that every time you go back to it, partially you're anticipating the possibility that you might have to learn something new. And as a designer, how do you sort of square that circle that you want people to be comfortable with things, but you also want to be changing them?
So that's where, you know, that previous one I said is learning what things people expect, like where things should be located, will help a new design stick better with people who are using those apps. Knowing a little bit of the rules like underneath, it'll help you like create new designs and create a new experience, new visual experience, while still keeping the same kind of underlying user experience, if that makes sense.
Yeah, no, that totally does. Mm-hmm. I've got another sort of, I guess this one's kind of from the trenches kind of question about just the day-to-day work that designers do, and then the experience that people have using what they build. I've got a particular, and this is a bit of a selfish question, but I've got a personal preoccupation with people hiding crucial information in design. And I've got a specific example. So when using Gmail, I find just incredibly frustrating, because Gmail is always trying to hide things from you. Like, for example, if I type in, I send from a number of different addresses in my same, in one Gmail account, and it always hides the address. As soon as I choose the address, like Len at Leanpub.
Oh, I know what you're talking about. Yeah.
It just shows Len Epp. And that could be any number of email addresses that it's sending from. And it will actually even hide the two and replace it with the name. But of course, you're not sending a message to a name. You're sending it to an address. And I like to say, you know, and it's you know, if you've ever had a job where you could go to jail for sending the wrong person some information, you become very sensitive to that kind of thing. And I remember one time working on a collaboration app, and one of our sort of, you know, design sort of leaning developers was always hiding stuff like that, just taking the initiative. We were a small team, and that's, you know, encouraged some initiative. And I remember asking him at one point, you know, why do you keep doing that? Like, why do you keep hiding that important information? And he said, well, I don't want to look at it. I don't want to look at the email address all the time. And so I guess I have two questions. One is just sort of, you know, the higher level one, which is, what do you think about this sort of trend of hiding useful information to make things look better? And how can you deal with obstreperous people who don't do what you tell them to?
So I will say, with Gmail, I agree with you completely. I would much prefer the email address. I'm actually looking at my Gmail right now. I would much prefer to see the entire email address. I remember when they launched that update where the compose window got so much smaller. They took away almost all the fields, and you had to then choose if you wanted to update the subject line. You had to like go into a drop down and say edit subject line rather than just having it there. Mm-hmm. And for someone with, I am a computer user, and I've been doing it for many, many years. And that drove me insane, because they broke away. They took away all that information that I needed. And the hardest part about being a designer, and to look at it from the other side, is designing for pro users like you and me that aren't scared of a subject line, aren't scared of multiple fields in email, while also designing for someone's tech illiterate family member who is using, they want to send an email for the first time and they're overwhelmed by the fact that they don't understand why an email address has that at sign in there. And it's much simpler for that person to see it's going to first name rather than first name at domain.com. So it's like, how do you combine both of those, you know, designing for someone like us who aren't scared of email addresses versus creating a better experience for someone who is tech illiterate rather than, and the one answer might be like, oh, that tech illiterate person needs to be tech literate and needs to not be scared by that. But I can see why. That's why Gmail doesn't take that tack. They try to make it better for the completely new user at the expense of people like you and me. So that's, I can see both sides. I can see why Gmail did what they did. I don't personally agree with it, but I'll bet when I think about decisions like that, I always think about Gmail, Google, Alphabet has 1.5 billion engineers and they probably tested this to high hell and somewhere in their testing, they decided it was a better experience. And so I have no good answer here. And then I'd saying I can see both sides and I guess I give more leeway to something as wide ranging as Gmail to hide those things. That said, for someone when you're, that's where knowing design and knowing your audience, Gmail has probably a large audience, tech illiterate people. Whereas designing for something where you are working with pro users, that's where hiding that kind of information can be a bad thing, where it can be more confusing than to a pro user than it is. If your audience is pro users and you're hiding information that makes it more confusing to a pro user, then you shouldn't hide that information. And I know that there is this thing about designers. That's pretty much the first half of my book is hiding clutter and how do you deal with clutter and design and how clutter makes an experience better. Excuse me, reducing clutter makes an experience better. And I can see designers being like, oh, I'm going to hide this information because it's going to reduce clutter and make the visual experience better. And that's why the second half of my book is on user experience, about testing these things and making sure that people actually can use stuff. So it's a very new designer trope about hiding information that's useful. Whereas, you know, for Gmail, I can see that being a point, but that's where something where if you're designing something that could be for pro users, you shouldn't be, you should also remember that hiding information, sometimes clutter in those situations can be a good thing.
Yeah, that's a really good distinction between the pro user and let's say the casual user and their different needs. And it brings up something that I've asked a couple of people about before on this podcast, but not an actual designer, which is that, you know, the designer themselves brings their experience to what they do.
And biases.
And biases, exactly. And limitations. And they might be tasked with designing something that they are neither a pro nor a casual user of. And I use a payments app to pay royalties to Leanpub authors. I'm not going to name it because I'm going to say something critical and I actually like it and I think it's a great service. but they did start a little while ago putting up, when you go to pay, well, first of all, they initially had a bunch of drop downs so you could just make all your selections for what you wanted to do on one page. They turned it into a wizard, which is incredibly frustrating. Because it doesn't, if you're three steps in, it doesn't show you what you've done in the previous steps. Mm. And since you're sending money, you know, you really want to know what's going on. But the one very frustrating thing that they started doing was when you go to pay, they start showing you circle faces and account names just randomly. And it just occurred to me looking at that, I'm like, no one who's ever sent $100,000 or $1 million mass payment, and no one who's ever been sending that $50 they really worked hard for, you know, so grandma can get a bus ticket and come and visit for Christmas, and there's no other $50 if you screw up. Nobody who ever had either of those experiences would ever serve up random circle faces to someone who's trying to make a payment. And it was just this very stark reminder that as important and as ubiquitous as these, you know, design interfaces are, how much the sort of person behind them is there in your face, and how much the sort of office politics are actually right there in your face, right? Because somebody's looking for a promotion, and, you know, let's say two people are saying, hey, each of you show me what you got for our redesign on Tuesday. And one person just says, no, what we've got works great. And another person is like, everybody likes, you know, circle faces and account names nowadays. And guess who wins that competition? And I know that's a very long story, but I mean, what do you think, you know, can be done to help get designers generally speaking, maybe at big companies, you know, out of their box?
Well, this is one reason why in Hello Web Design, I did the first half on visual, on learning how to like deal with clutter and how to make visual design better. But the second, I try to be very clear that the most important thing is the data and what's actually happening and how well people are actually using what you're designed, because it's not just how it looks, but how it works. And it actually reminded me of a story. Your story reminded me of a design experience that I had a while back where I was using Periscope. Because I don't usually join I haven't looked at a lot of people doing live video on Periscope, except when there was a wildfire going through where I grew up, especially the mountains where I mentioned earlier where I grew up. There was this huge wildfire last year that actually tore through a town. This is the Valley Fire that went through Middletown, if anyone remembers that. And I was in my house in San Jose, just knowing that my mountains were on fire. And I go on Twitter and I was searching for like hashtag Valley Fire to see what people are saying. And people were posting Periscopes of them escaping the wildfire. So naturally I'm watching these Periscopes, and it's a really surreal experience to be using tech and watching, like being on live video of people escaping the mountains I grew up in because it's all on fire. The thing was, Periscope has this feature where you can heart a feed if someone's doing a live feed, and then everyone who's watching it will have this little explosion of hearts from the side showing that people are enjoying what's going on. And having a little explosion of hearts does not make any sense when you're watching if someone escaping a wildfire. Like it's a design decision that makes sense when you're thinking of someone live streaming, learning how to code, but live streaming escaping a fire, hearts are not the metaphor that you want to have when you're watching that. It was just really, I can see the point behind the design, but the designers didn't think about what they've built being used in that context, which is a lesson we learned for a lot of designers out there.
Yeah, that reminds me of the now forgotten huge controversy of Twitter switching from stars to hearts.
Yes, I know. I wish it wasn't forgotten. It still bugs me.
Yeah. No, it's funny how those things just become part of the background. Before moving on to asking you about your really interesting experience running successful Kickstarters and how you wrote your book and stuff like that, I skipped a question I wanted to ask you, and you just reminded me of it when you talked about the wildfires in California where you grew up. And the question is, why did you move to in winter, icy Toronto and all the mountainless
yes. Toronto? It was a really hard decision. my husband, that same guy I talked about before, is originally from Toronto. So he had pretty much a 7-year campaign convincing me to move up here. And during those 7 years, it's constantly me being like, no, there's no mountains. No, it's cold there. No, it's a completely different country. And then last summer, it was finally, I had finally been in Toronto enough to fall in love with the city. And I finally got to the point in my life where I lived in California my entire life. And that's last summer, I kind of realized that, you know, moving to a different country and being in a city for the first time. I've always lived in rural or suburbs. So this is my first time living in a city. My first time in the cold, really. That was hard to get used to. It's actually just getting cold now. And it's been kind of upsetting because I've had to break out my giant knee-length marshmallow puffy coat that I think every other Torontonian looks at me and laughs because it's like, oh, that's really obvious. There's a Californian running around in Toronto because it's not that cold yet. It was a bunch of things. It was last summer. I don't want to go into politics, but it turned out to be a really good decision to start moving.
I was just about to say, some people might say you got out right in time.
Yeah, that was an accident, a happy accident. I'm really happy to be in Canada now, and I'm really happy with what Canada has been doing in the world. There's, and Toronto has been a really wonderful and multicultural liberal city to be a part of. So that was an accident. It was not on purpose. It's been a happy accident to have a Canadian husband at this time, though.
Yeah, it's a big change weather-wise and politics-wise.
I miss the mountains, really. We drove 5 hours north and it was still flat. I was like, this place is so flat. So I've been, because I still speak at conferences, I've been trying to, I'll fly to a conference and speak there, and I try to spend a couple extra days seeing the local area. So a month ago, I was in Spain in San Sebastian, which is a wonderful city. And I was able to do an all-day hike into another town, go there for lunch. And earlier this year, I was in Italy and I walked for 4 days on the Via Francigena, which is the Camino de Santiago in Spain. There's one in Italy as well. So I was able to spend some time backpacking. So basically I've been trying to, now that I live in a city and I have no mountains, I love backpacking and being outside. I've been trying to combine that with my travels, so I get that outdoor time that I need from my old days as a Californian.
Yeah, well, that sounds like a really awesome solution to that problem, to travel.
Yeah, except right now I'm burnt out on speaking, so I'm not going to be speaking for a while. I've decided not to do any conference submissions for at least 6 months because this month, I was in Spain and then I was in Chicago and then I was in Ireland and then I did a personal trip to Iceland all in 1 month. And I was at the end of that. I'm very lucky that I could do that, but I'm going to take a break now.
Yeah, thanks for telling that story. That was really, really those are big, big changes. Moving on to the subject of your work as an author, a big part, you've talked a little bit about your books, but a big part of being an author, and particularly a self-published author, is getting attention. And you've been very good at that. You've run three... Well, I would say you've run three successful Kickstarter campaigns. You raised over $20,000 in your campaign for Hello Web Design. And I was wondering if you could, just for anyone listening, if you could talk a little bit about your experience and, what you did running those campaigns.
Thanks for reminding me to be thankful, because I get in this problem. I think everyone does. We always look at someone who's doing better than you. Yeah. And then you don't feel like you're doing as well as you actually are. And as I'm doing that right now with because Hello Web Design came out last week and I'm 1 week in and I'm like, it's not as good as it could have been. But I think actually it actually has been doing well. And I've just been kicking myself. So thanks for the reminder that my Kickstarter was awesome. I'm really glad that for all three books, I've done a Kickstarter, and it's a really good way for me to judge if people want what I'm writing. And it's also really good as a way of getting an advance for a book without going through a publisher, because, a publisher could say, okay, I'm gonna give you $8,000 and then take 95% of your royalties. Yes. Versus taking a lot of effort, but doing a Kickstarter, getting a chunk of money as an advance, and then you have 100% of the royalties. It just made sense to me when working on Hello Web App. Actually, I should back up. I actually got a publishing house gave me an offer for Hello Web App, and I ended up turning it down because I looked at the effort required to do it myself. And I've decided that I'd much rather have the 100% of the royalties and do everything myself rather than go through a publisher. And I'm happy with that decision. I think it was a good decision. Am I missing?
Go ahead. In particular to reach out to people, or you put up a page on Kickstarter, but I assume you did other things as well.
Yes. Kickstarters, I lovingly say, are 30 days of hell. It's ridiculous how much stress a Kickstarter can be, because you think, I'm just going to put this page up and people will come. No, obviously with anything in the world, you can't just put a page up and expect it to just be rolling and donations. You have to do a lot of work. So for the two programming books, I launched those books. I did the Kickstarters around big programming conferences. So one year, one of them was during PyCon, which is the largest Python programming conference in the world, I believe. And then the other one was during a DjangoCon, which is because it's on Django. It's during the US DjangoCon conference. So that meant I was able to go to those conferences where there were programming rock stars, and I can go to them in person, be like, hi, I have a Kickstarter. Can you tweet my Kickstarter and help me promote it? And in person, people usually say yes. So I did a lot of legwork, really, just tracking down people and making sure in person that they were helping me promote those campaigns. And doing it at those conferences was really a good way of drumming up a lot of anticipation. For Hello Web Design, I decided to do something different, and it actually wasn't that successful. I launched the Kickstarter campaign, and I decided to do this city tour where I did a talk at a company in Toronto, and then I flew to New York and I did a talk at a company there, and then I flew to San Francisco and did a talk at a company there. And I thought that would be a good way for me to go to these cities and talk to people in person without having a conference. I get more ground covered. And I actually did not do as well as, say, running a Kickstarter during a conference. I guess at a conference, I think people are talking about that thing and a lot more thinking about that thing. Whereas I did these talks, and I expect the companies that I was talking at would help back the campaign, because I was doing free talks. I talked at I shouldn't think their name. That'd be mean. There was a big, big company in New York. I did an internal talk with them, and they were the talk ended at, it was like 10 to 11, or excuse me, no, it was 11 to 12. And 12 hit, I finished my talk, and they just like took me to the front door and said, okay, bye. Thanks for that. And I didn't get lunch. I didn't get any backing from the company. I asked them, I was like, hey, would you mind helping out with the campaign? And they're like, nah. And I was like, my God, I flew myself to New York and I put myself up and I did a talk at your company for your employees and nothing. And I didn't expect that. I thought I would be able to get some kind of campaign contribution from doing these things. So that didn't work out. Conferences worked out a lot better. Lesson learned this time around. Maybe I just need to do it differently. I did have a public talk at Stripe in San Francisco. That was nice, but it didn't really lead to a lot of campaign contributions. So that was one way I helped promote the Kickstarter that's different than what you'd see in most how to run a Kickstarter articles. That was something that I did a little bit differently. But I did a lot of normal things that people do with Kickstarters, which was writing blog posts and submitting to Reddit and Hacker News and asking all my friends to donate, because I say Kickstarters are the nice way to ask your friends for money. Right. a lot of people are very supportive of what I do. Mm-hmm. But yeah, the in-person thing I think works really well if you can time it around the right events.
Yeah, thanks for that. I hadn't actually heard that very useful and specific example of something you can do, but that sounds really mm-hmm. good. And you know, thanks for sharing the stories of the ones that do work and the ones that don't work as well, because I think it's yeah. important when you're out there doing this kind of thing, you have to just expect, and I mean, I'm saying this as someone who knows it but can't live it, that you have to expect that some things aren't going to work out, some people aren't going to be nice, you know, and that's just part of being out there and doing things.
I wouldn't say I regret it, but I'm glad that I went through the experience so I know what to avoid in the future, because I'm sure I'm going to write another book.
One of the really interesting things that you do around your books as well is that it's not just put up a web page or something like that. You have dedicated websites and Twitter accounts, email newsletters, and you know, you're always doing updates and adding new resources, including workshops and free tutorials. And one thing that you do as well is you use the app Discourse at least for Hello Web app, where readers can go and basically talk to each other and exchange information. And I just discovered that last night and got authorization to reveal that we're going to be using Discourse on Leanpub.
Yay!
And it's something, I mean, we've had discuss, like DISQUS pages mm-hmm. for books since, you know, for many years, but they've been underused and underpromoted. And the social side of things has been one of our huge gaps, right? Because a big part of Leanpub is actually about authors who, if they choose to, can interact with readers to improve their books if they're publishing them in progress. And so we're really excited to be releasing this. And I just wanted to ask you a little bit about how discourse has worked for you. Have you found that readers like it? Why did you choose discourse?
Well, first I want to say, I love Leanpub. That's awesome that you guys are doing that. I haven't said that yet in this podcast, how much I appreciate your platform. So I'll put that out there now. Thank you so much. With discourse, writing a book teaching people how to program, because I went through it myself, I know how scary it can be, especially if you're working on your own and you have no one to ask questions. And that's really a key to learning how to program, is being able to ask the questions and get answers and feeling not alone. And I wanted to have a place where people could ask me questions and ask the silly things that's going wrong. Or I guess I had this fear of someone taking my book and being like, I don't understand this, and not having any place to ask. So I started working at Discourse because it was easy for me to build and launch. Like there, I think I used a tutorial to deploy it on Docker. And this is one of those things, again, I say I'm a programmer, but there's so many things I do things, I don't understand what's working on, how it's working in the background. But as long as it's working, I'm happy. So I did this tutorial verbatim, like how to launch Discourse on Docker and on DigitalOcean, which is what I'm using. And I was able to do it step by step. And at the end I had a form. So I was like, cool, this is perfect. It's much easier to use. Side note, back in the day when I launched WeddingLovely, I decided to build a forum for WeddingLovely for people to talk. And I used one of the forum softwares that was really popular in like the early 2000s. And it was just swarmed with spam immediately. It was like thousands of spam messages every single day. And then because of software, I paid like $100 for it, which was a lot of money for me back then. And I just couldn't use it because it was a PHP software, forum software, awful. So I had to completely shut it down and wasted my $100. So with Discourse, I was kind of like, I remember this experience running a forum and I was like, oh no, I don't want to be swamped with spam. And I think someone recommended it to me as the one that has the best spam detection protocols for a forum. And I will say that they do a really good job not having hundreds of spam messages every single day. So that was one of the reasons why I used it. It's been really successful for Hello Web App, because when people email me directly, I can say, hey, can you go to the forum and answer your question there? And about half the time now, by the time they've added their question, someone else that I don't know has responded to it. And this is still a mystery to me where these people came from, and I love them. I should call them, I should give them a flare and call them angels or something like that. Cause I expected the forum, when people ask questions, that I'd be the person answering. I didn't expect people to be hanging around. It's not really a good community thing for Hello Web App. It's just the place where people ask me questions and people can search questions. But there are people using it as a community resource that aren't me, aren't people I know. And that was the biggest surprise to me that happened. And I think that Discourse, that being it's such a good piece of online software, helped that happen.
Oh, well, thanks very much for telling us that story. That's actually really useful.
Mm-hmm.
And in particular, if someone emails you directing them to the forum, not as a way of getting them off your back, but as a way of sharing their question and your response or someone else's responses with everybody who's reading the book. And so it actually brings this utility to something by making it public rather than keeping it private.
Yeah, it's been a huge time saver for me for the programming stuff. I don't think I would do something like that for design. It's the hardest part about teaching design is that there's no like right or wrong answer. There's no way of saying like, this is the way to go. It's always like shades of black and white. So I don't think I'll add like a design forum. There's other places online like Designer News that exist for asking design questions, but it definitely worked really well for answering programming questions.
At the end of these interviews, I always like to ask a couple of Leanpub specific questions. One I'd like to ask is, why did you choose to use Leanpub to make your books?
Leanpub's ebook generation has just been invaluable for me. I don't think I could do it from scratch at all. I originally chose it because I was building a programming book and I knew people that forget who, but someone said, Leanpub, they're really great with programming books. And I know that Leanpub has other books, but like they especially excel with programming and work the building books for programmers. So I was like, oh, I should check this out. And then I used it with my Markdown files to create the EPUB and the Kindle version of my book. And I was like, it was like, oh, done for me. So that was awesome. And I don't think I will ever build an ebook from scratch ever again. I just, the fact I can write a Markdown and then push into Leanpub and have those ebooks generated has been awesome.
Okay, great. Well, thanks for that. That's really good feedback. And actually my last question is, and the answer, sometimes people are don't have an answer to this, so that's okay if you don't. But if there was one thing we could build or one thing we could fix for you, what would you ask us to do?
So my latest book, the design book, I actually took, because you say in there, your terms and conditions or whatever page, that you can take the files and move them onto Amazon and sell it as a Kindle book, which is also an amazing policy. I'm so happy. I actually rechecked it to make sure that stuck around, because it feels like such a something that most services don't let you do. They don't say, hey, feel free to take these files and use them elsewhere. So thank you, Leanpub, for that. That said, this design book, I wanted to put it on Kindle with better, a little bit better design. I want to have a little bit more designy, and the generated files. As a designer, I wanted to have a little bit more ability to update some of the way that the chapter headings were laid out. So I did that myself manually with CSS. Didn't take me that long, but they look, with a little bit of updates, they look a lot better. And just it would be kind of cool if I had some way to do that in Leanpub, some way of making a little bit more design changes, even though I know that Leanpub's, one of the Leanpub strengths is the fact that all the books are designed in the same way. So they're super readable. You don't have to deal with designery nonsense. But maybe there's a halfway point. Maybe there's something else that I could do to please a designer in me.
Yeah, thanks for that. That's really good feedback. And I like the very specific nature of it as well. That's really good to know, because, I mean, you know, if I've never had anyone say specifically chapter headings, I don't think, before, but those are actually very important parts of, you know, that's the first thing you see.
That's like the only thing I really changed was just the chapter headings.
Yeah, we've had occasionally we have had that request, you know, can I have more control over the design? And it's this sort of, and I imagine that at some point in the future we may add more functionality around that. For us, there's an interesting kind of philosophical issue at stake, which is that when people are writing, they shouldn't be worried about how things look. When you're writing words, you probably shouldn't be too worried about how things look.
Right.
But, you know, if you're writing a book, you're probably an opinionated perfectionist. or at least you may more likely than just the average person to be. And I know from my own experience, you know, making web pages and writing, you know, books and stuff like that, that, you know, the temptation to format is just always there. I mean, and you can sit down and you've got your brilliant idea, and all of a sudden it's 3 hours later and you've got to go and, like, you found the right font or something like that. And you didn't write your chapter. So that's something that we do. I mean, it's particular to Leanpub, because Leanpub,
which I totally agree with.
Because Leanpub is for in progress publishing partly as well. And so we really want to reflect in our design. We have that reflected. And one of the ways we reflect that is, hey, like, we know that it sort of sucks in a way to not have as much control over how things are going to look in the end. But by the way, you're not done. Get off the book theme page and, you know, get back to writing.
Yeah, I know. This thing I knew is just, it's me being nitpicky designer, but it's also because I have that background in editorial design, and I did the design of the print books as well. Mm-hmm. So I knew that I'm a little bit of an anomaly, and I overall think that you're making the right decision.
Yeah, well, thanks for letting us know. I mean, we do, you know, at least I can speak for myself. You know, I often, as you were saying before, you always look at the people who are doing better. And when you're, you know, behind an app that people are using, you're always thinking about its weaknesses and not necessarily its strengths. And so it's good to hear about it. You know, that, you know, I guess 99.9% of it worked right for you, and those damn chapter headings needed some tweaking.
That's why I'll never make an ebook from scratch and have to deal with all the crane doing all that. It's not worth it for me, especially even as a designer and having a background in doing HTML and CSS. And no, I've just, that's why Leanpub is my favorite.
Well, on that note, thanks very much for taking the time to do this interview. I really enjoyed it. We covered a lot of ground. Thanks for being a Leanpub author.
Yeah, thanks for having me and featuring my book and being the supporter of what I do, too. Thank you so much.
Thanks.